Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Deepika. You're watching Thomas Creation. This is my documentary film, The Science Behind Popular Indian Tradition. Hey guys, just to hear our people said, don't do that, it's not our tradition. Before every don't do that has certain reasons. Just you guys think what is the reason behind them? Now I will tell you some reasons what I get in now. Let's get into the topic. India, pristine ground of spirituality. A land with a 7,000-year-old history. A land held to its ancient traditions, embedded with fruits of its deep-rooted culture, passed on through generations, sentiment intact. Despite having belonged to this society with innumerable, we lack the understanding of the logical reason behind several rituals and customs, and brand them superstitious and meaningless. Why do we visit temples? Idol worship is a form of prayer. But what is the reason behind installing these idols in magnificently constructed temples? What is the purpose of temples at all? Temples are constructed in zones where positive vibrations from the earth's magnetic and electric fields can be tapped in abundance. The peak of this energy is felt at Garbhagriha or the Sanctum Sanctorum, where the deity is installed. People are asked to walk barefoot in temples so that the radiation is easily absorbed. Why must the temple be the tallest construction in the entire town? An unsaid rule from the ancient time is that the temple should be the tallest construction in that particular town or city. We see this rule in prevalence in the Agraharam style of civilization in rural areas. The reason commonly stated is that God is the supreme and hence the temple must be the tallest. The actual reason behind this practice is the absorbing power of the temple gopuram. The gopuram is usually filled with paddy on the inside, which is an excellent absorbent of shock waves. Wherever lightning hits the village, the rays are diverted to the gopuram, and the excess harmful rays are transmitted to the earth. Beneficial cosmic rays from the atmosphere are retained by the paddy and radiated inside the temple. What is the purpose of conducting the Abhishekam? There have been debates regarding conducting Abhishekams for stone idols in temples. These days old granite idols have the tendency, it seems to be like. Regular contact with agents such as milk, honey and oil help in keeping the idol intact, thus preserving these ancient sculptures. Another interesting observation is that the base on which these idols are mounted is made of specially alloy of gold, silver and traces of lead, which having medicinal properties when combined with milk and honey. This is why milk and panchamrutam from the Abhishekam that are distributed are said to have special properties that cure many diseases. The Ganesha under the peepal tree. It's a popular deity of worship among men. There is a common belief that women who are unable to conceive will be able to do so if they visit this vinayagar every day in the early hours of the morning with the wet clothes after a shower and walks in circle around the tree. The secret behind the miraculous success of this practice is the peepal tree. This tree is known to give out high amount of oxygen and very minimal amount of carbon dioxide through the day. Oxygen is said to be the best cure for hormonal imbalances in the body and naturally brings undernourished organs back to normalcy. Gradually, the hormones in the uterus start functioning routinely and the woman is able to conceive. Wet clothes help in absorption of oxygen, thus ensuring maximum benefit of the ritual. Why do we feed crows before a meal? In the Indian tradition, crows are given special importance as they are considered ancestors. After the meal for the day is prepared, a portion of every dish is kept outside for crows to feast on so that the members of the family have the satisfaction. Are they really our ancestors or have our forefathers just been spinning yarns? There is an interesting reason behind these age-old traditions. Earlier on, where there was no electricity and hence no proper light in the early hours of the morning, people were doubtful of the food they cooked. The crow, as we all know, is a creature that can eat. Interestingly, it can sense the presence of any kind of poison in food. It simply refuses food if it senses poison in it. People from the ancient times happened to use the crow as a tester for food smartly without harming it. The wholesome Indian cuisine. When it comes to the food system, Indian cuisine is one of the most balanced regimens, including optimum quantities of all nutrients conceived into delicious dishes that are easily digestible. Our ancestors even had appropriate meal timings devised to ensure proper and timely metabolism and digestion. For adequate energy to carry out tasks through the day. As an ancient custom says, the best kind of diet for any human being or animal living in a region is the diet consisting of foods grown in the same area. We have essentially evolved through the years to belong to a tropical climate and be accustomed to the foods and lifestyle offered by this region. With the arrival of foreign cultures and lifestyle, the concept of eating out was a proper abode with the expansion and trade of foreign cuisines, which sadly are not the best suited diets for the Indian stomach. Most importantly, eating outside food greatly disturbed the timing of meals. We may believe that the only consequences of ill-timed meals are acidity and gastroenteritis. But actually, the human body functions by a system flow between organs. Ancient scriptures of naturopathy and manuscripts of Ayurveda hold reference to the organ clock. Okay, thank you for watching this video. I hope you may like this concept. Please do like, share, subscribe. Jai Hind. Thank you.